Camello and the Blue World. When the world was only new, it was painted blue, above, below, and all around. Stately cerulean dyes stretched across the skies in broad and expansive bounds. The world's waters were thus blessed with a deep blue dress in which the rough seas were gowned. When the night's twinkling gems shone on the sea's blue tones, their lights winked and played around. In ebon and indigo, colors all aglow, the vast galaxy is gowned. Planets and comets that veer past the heavens were the sole colors to be found. Apart from them, constellations as large as the sun covered the heavens with sound and filled the space with their forms. Leisure was the norm. They never thought thoughts profound. Yet, one constellation dared to consult and share some ideas to propound. He straightened up and stood tall before the great hall, ever ready to expound.
"Greetings. I am Camello. I bid you hello," he addressed the cluster's crowd. "My fellow constellations of night's nations, hear me now as I propound the project I'm putting forth. I wish to go forth and explore the lower grounds. I discovered from afar a world without stars, but oceans stretched in bounds. We can make it just like ours, full of light and hours of merrymaking abound."
"Why should we care for a world that's forever pearled in seas? Here, you're safe and sound among starry skies astir," said the star clusters, who were eager to confound the project of Camello with thoughts of their own. He said was asked to expound.
"I want to travel beyond, for the skies are thrown with myriad clusters now. The heavens are resplendent and incandescent by the lucid blazing crowns of the sun and the moon so fair. Instead, why not share our colors of great renown to a large world that's only empty and lonely? The world beneath us is drowned in an endless silent blue. What I say is true. We can give it life and sound. Will you join me as I go to the world below?"
All the constellations frowned as they sat there and listened while their forms glistened. Voices stern, they spoke aloud. "We understand your desire to leave the higher realm, to see the lower grounds where varied-colored fishes swim with swift swishes on the waters that surround their home. And yet, you must learn that you can't return home once you've descended down."
"I see," Camello concurred. He stayed undeterred. His bold answer did astound those present at the meeting. Their shock was fleeting, for they began to resound the hall with peals of laughter.
He then left after and prepared for the trip down. He brought with him the finest jewels, plucked from the best stars in the celestial grounds. He picked diamonds as clear as a stream of tears that trickles down in sweet sounds. He picked pearls as white as milk and as smooth as silk than all earthly treasures found. He also took emeralds, whose glint never dulled, even if they were cloth-bound. He even took corundum that plopped and dropped from the nebula's lustrous crown. Next, he plucked precious turquoise from the disused toys of the celestial playground. Last of all, he scooped some gusts of the cosmic dust that was scattered all around. All the constellations old knew the dust as gold. In the sky, it was renowned as the most precious treasure beyond all measure, for as it glistered, it crowned the inky blackness of night with their yellow light, sprinkled and spangled around. Bedecked in a mahawi, he felt quite ready to make the long descent down. In dyed saddlebags called horj, Camello then stored all the twinkling jewels he found. He bid his old home goodbye as he left the sky. He heard the faint murmur sound of his friends sending him off with indifferent scoffs and distant indignant frowns. Camello sailed the galaxies till he saw the seas that flooded the world and drowned. To keep himself from sinking, he got through sprinkling a handful of gold around. As groups of gold were disposed, bits of land arose, till it turned into a mound. Then he said,
"It's lonely here, and everything is drear. Something has to be done now."
First, he cast the diamonds cold. Then lo and behold, the once watery surrounds began to transform and change to a mountain range that elevated a bound. Next, he spat the milky pearls and watched them make swirls in the blue above the ground, turning into clouds. The pearls rolled up in white furls and flecked the blue in white bounds. Third, he hurled the emeralds, which became heralds of verdant forest abound. Fourth, he threw all the turquoise with elegant poise and stared with awe as they gowned several varying hues of majestic blues that became the skies around. Fifth, he flung the corundum as one does with crumbs. When they sank further down, they reshaped into islands and plains and grasslands with fresh soil fecund and brown. Last, he blew the cosmic dust, which made waves adjust into undulating mounds of the dusty desert dunes. In the warm forenoon, the sands drifted in soft sounds. While the lands began to form, new animals swarmed and verdure grew from the ground. Camello beamed, bright with pride. However, he spied excess water rim the ground. Before he could think again, he felt a sudden urge to drink. And he frowned, for he had not drank since he arrived at the sea. So he knelt down the sand mound and gulped down the water's cool until he was full. When he stood again, he found that the waters receded at a height needed to be even with the ground. A hump had grown on his back, and like a large sack, it stored the water he dabbed. Camello knew he transformed as air filled his form, mirroring the desert's brown. Now that a new world was built, his quest was fulfilled. Glad at last, Camello found a home among the sand dunes, and for many moons he stayed in the earthly grounds. He led people lost in sand, known throughout the land as the first camel around.